Dear friends, I am presenting to you Missionary Ewald Frank, whose ministry spans over 6 decades and has travelled to more than 157 countries for the preaching of the gospel.
Turn away from old man-made interpretations and teachings and return to the Lord that he might receive you. Know the truth, and the truth is the word of God.
Missionary Ewald Frank will be coming to Birmingham for revival meetings, and you are cordially invited to participate in these meetings. These meetings take place on the 8th and 9th of August 2015 at South Ashton United Reformed Church, Upper Sutton Street, Ashton, Birmingham, B6 5BN. Saturday service starts at 3 p.m. and Sunday service begins at 2 p.m. Telephone numbers are on screen. Come and hear the Biblical End Time Message.
Need the Holy Spirit to understand the Word of God. There's only one God, besides whom there is no other. For heaven and earth shall pass away, but God's Word will remain. In every way, the last message is reaching the ends of the earth. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Brother Frank speaking to you from the International Mission Center in Krefeld, Germany. I wish you God's richest blessings. We are sharing the true word of God in this apostolic prophetic ministry. Just going back to the word of God, not using a single interpretation, but believing God's word as it came forth from the lips of the Almighty. A true servant of God has the duty and the responsibility to say precisely what God said, and we must not add a single word or take away, but leave all things where they are and how they are. We're, of course, living in a time when people lost the divine orientation, when all denominations have their own teachings, their own statements of faith, and all use the same Bible, speak about the same God, and all go into different directions. In our preachings and teachings, we have to come to the various aspects the Scripture declares. We have to pay attention to the evangelistic part, to call people to Christ, to a personal experience and relationship to our Lord and Savior. Then we have to take charge of the teaching ministry to bring out the real Bible doctrines of the apostles and prophets. And then, of course, we must take the part of the prophetic Scripture, which gives us orientation right when time moves into eternity and the God of heaven shall reign and we shall be with him also for all eternity. Coming to the first point, we read in Matthew 24, verse 14. Our Lord speaking, this gospel of the kingdom must be preached to all nations as a witness, and then the end shall be. The same can be read in Mark 13, verse 10, and the gospel must first be proclaimed among the nations. The same you can read in Luke 21. And beloved, I just must say that we are now living at the very end of the time of grace. I'm not here to scare you, but I'm here to warn you, because God always gives a warning before judgment. First, God offers grace. He calls people to repentance. And if you go back to the beginning of the New Testament, John the Baptist prepared the way of the Lord. He preached repentance, that people should return to the Lord, repent of their sins, and be prepared to receive the Lord as their Savior. Then the same applies to the first sermon of the Apostle Peter on the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit fell and the New Testament church was brought to life. Beloved, that is the scriptural pattern. If anybody preaches any other gospel than was preached from the first day when the New Testament church began, beloved, there's something wrong. But the scripture declares, Paul the apostle writes about it in very strong terms. He speaks about it, especially 2 Corinthians 11, 1 to 3, that people would rise who preach another Jesus, another gospel, having received another spirit. And then, of course, in Galatians chapter 1, in a very strong way, he says, if anyone, even if an angel comes from heaven preaching any other gospel, the curse is upon him. Beloved, back to the beginning, the New Testament church at the end must be where she was at the very, very beginning, when no strange teachings, no other spirits were at work, but the Holy Spirit infilling everyone, starting with the 120, and then, according to the scripture, there were 3,000 who believed the message the Apostle Peter preached. And according to Acts chapter 2, verse 41, all who believed were baptized. All who believed were baptized. This brings us back to Matthew 28, 19 and 20, where our Lord said that we should baptize into the name, singular, into the name in which God manifested himself as Father in heaven, in his only begotten Son on earth, and by the Holy Spirit through the church. It's one name, Emmanuel, God with us, Jesus Christ, our Lord. If you go to Matthew chapter 1, thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. We don't want to go into the significance of the original meaning of that name, but the name of the Lord God in the Old Testament was Yahweh, and the name of the Lord God in the New Testament was Yahshua, which doesn't need an interpretation. It just simply means Yahweh, Savior, no more and no less. Just as Emmanuel doesn't need to be interpreted, it simply means God with us. Emmanuel, God with us. Yahshua, Yahweh, Savior. We know the name Jesus, which is being used in most of the languages on earth, but I'm talking at this moment of the original Hebrew name of our Lord and Savior. Now, if we go to Mark chapter 16, there we are told that those who believe and are baptized shall be saved. Beloved, that is the truth. You cannot say, I believe, and refuse to be baptized. Then your revelation somehow has not happened or is wrong. Anyone believing, truly believing in Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, how could you refuse to be baptized when the Holy Scripture says that all who believed were baptized? And even the Apostle Paul, first thing that he would see again, and he was baptized. Everywhere the gospel was preached and people experienced the grace of God, they became obedient to the word of God. This is what must happen in our day and time. Then coming to the teaching point, beloved, it is so important to have the true Bible teachings. It's good to preach the gospel, but it must be the full gospel. And the full gospel includes the whole salvation of the soul, body, and spirit. The whole man is redeemed on the cross of Calvary. Our sins were forgiven. Our sickness was taken to the cross. Our Lord bore our own sickness, and he took it to the cross, and he gave up his spirit, and we're all to be freed from every other spirit and receive the Spirit of God, because they who don't have the Spirit of Christ, they don't have life, and they don't have him as personal Savior. So the full gospel is not just healing and miracles. The full gospel is the salvation of the soul, the deliverance of the spirit, the healing of the body. And it includes baptism. It includes first repentance. And as the first sermon was preached, repent everyone and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. Then we understand what our Lord said in John chapter 20. As my Father has sent me, so send I you. And then we come to verse 23 in John chapter 20, where our Lord said, whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted, and unto them whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained. How can I forgive and how can I retain? It's through the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's very easy It must be done in every sermon. We must tell the people, if you believe in Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, your sins are forgiven as certain as Jesus Christ, the Son of God, shed his blood on the cross of Calvary. You are redeemed. Just believe it, receive it, and it must and will be your personal experience. At the same time, we have to say to those who don't believe, your sins are not remitted because you don't believe. Unbelief condemns us. Belief justifies us. And those who believe receive the remission of their sins. And those who don't believe, they simply don't receive. In fact, they do reject the forgiveness of their sins. So you understand by now, beloved brothers and sisters, dear friends, it's not just taking one scripture, but you have to go from scripture to scripture to put all things into the right place and right connection to understand the things pertaining to our salvation and to the plan of salvation in a correct way. Then, coming to the second part, the teaching. We all know that baptism is also included in the true teaching. In Matthew 28:20, our Lord said to teach all nations. First, to preach the gospel, and then to teach all nations. This we must do. But if you go back to Luke 24, our Lord spent 40 days with his disciples, teaching his disciples after he rose from the dead. And after he taught them, he of course sent them with a divine commission to teach the nations, that they should teach them to observe all things he had told, he had taught them. Beloved, this is it. Not coming from different Bible schools and seminars where people present the different teachings according to the different denominations. The time has come when we must return to the Word of God and go back to the Holy Scripture. Maybe this just speaks to me in a tremendous way. Recently, I had the privilege to speak in one of the largest meetings ever in the 44 years of my ministry. There were thousands gathered, and it was a full gospel meeting. And beloved brothers and sisters, then the moment came when something happened, which seemed to be the case on every Sunday morning, that the Lord's Supper, which some call communion, I don't. I call it the Lord's Supper because that's the term the Word of God gives us and our Lord was also using. But the problem I just wish to touch on is this. The gentleman, the bishop, read Acts chapter 2, verse 42. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. But this church that I was speaking in and was invited as a guest speaker to address thousands of people refuses the doctrines of the apostles, remains in the doctrines that were presented by the Roman Church and adopted by all the Protestant churches when it comes to the teaching of the Trinity and also triune baptism and so forth. But using this word, reading to thousands of people, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, and not even considering the doctrines of the apostles. Beloved brothers and sisters, we might use the scripture and we might misuse the scripture. The time has come to check up, as in Revelation chapter 2, we are told, you tried those who claim, who profess to be apostles, and they are not. You found them to be liars. Why? Why? Because they claimed to be apostles. They claimed to be in the apostles' teaching. But when comparing with the teachings of the apostles, they had different teachings. So, if the apostles were right, which I believe, then the rest are wrong. There's only one truth and many interpretations. One God, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. So, the second part was, and in fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and then in prayers. But there was no breaking of bread. There was a pile of beautifully round vessels with many, many thousands of glasses, small, very small glasses. There was no cup, like our Lord said, and the scripture testifies of him. He took the bread first, and then he broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples, and they all ate. And he took the cup, and he blessed it, and they all partook of that cup. Beloved, here I didn't see a bread. They're round wafers, which are being used in the Catholic Church. Thousands of wafers were there. There was no bread. There was no cup. There was no wine. There was grape juice. And then the scriptures being read, and they continued steadfastly. There was no continuation in that church and no steadfastness in the apostles' teaching. In fact, they reject the apostles' teaching openly. And then when the brother told me after the service, he said, Brother Frank, we respect you and your ministry, but we don't want you to touch our doctrines. What am I to do? Am I to please man or to please God? Am I to preach the true word of God, the true doctrines of the apostles, the true breaking of bread? Beloved brothers, from the very time, and that was in 1953, so it's over 50 years ago, when I started to preach, I never administered the Lord's Supper in any other way, except that a bread was baked by holy hands without leaven, and that bread was taken to the church, and we blessed it, we prayed over it, and we broke it, and all partook. I never had the Lord's Supper in any other way except one cup, and the cup was blessed, and all partook of that cup. Beloved brothers, we could go into detail in teaching, but we do have brochures dealing with these certain Bible doctrines, and I wish for all of you to feel free to write us, to be informed. And beloved, just only one more scripture pertaining to the time we're living in. Verily, I say unto you, this generation shall not pass until all be fulfilled. We are living in the time of fulfillment of Bible prophecies. And God has sent William Branham in our generation for a specific purpose, to bring us back to the true teachings of the Holy Scripture, so that the bride of Christ will be a word-believing bride, being obedient to the word, submitting to the Lord, so that he can have his way with all of us. Many, many things need to be taught, need to be said. We shall do so, God willing, in the other sermons. And at this moment, I wish to tell you that God blesses this ministry in many, many countries, and the last call is going forth. May God bless you and be with you in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Who is the his? Who is the beast? What is the number? What is the name? What is the beast? What is the image of the beast? What is the mark? What is the name? What does Bible prophecy tell us about these important things in the end time?
Dear friends, I'm presenting to you Missionary Ewald Frank, whose ministry spans over 6 decades and has travelled to more than 157 countries for the preaching of the gospel.
Turn away from all man-made interpretations and teachings and return to the Lord that he might receive you. Know the truth, and the truth is the word of God.
Missionary Ewald Frank will be coming to Birmingham for revival meetings, and you are cordially invited to participate in these meetings. These meetings take place on 8th and 9th of August 2015 at South Ashton United Reformed Church, Upper Sutton Street, Ashton, Birmingham, B6 5BN. Saturday service starts at 3 p.m. and Sunday service begins at 2 p.m. Telephone numbers are on screen. Come and hear the Biblical End Time Message.